And I kept thinking, man, maybe there's an audience out there. We might go beyond their Sub Pop crowd. Maybe we can sell a couple hundred thousand records.
We predicted or hoped the projection for Nevermind would reach 50,000 copies, and that was based on the fact that Sonic Youth's Goo album had sold 100,000 or so to that point. And we felt that if Nirvana could do half of what Sonic Youth had done on DGC, that would be success.
When I was introducing the record to the company, that I said to them that, if we worked really, really hard and we got a little bit lucky with the video, and the band didn't implode, that, over the course of a year, that we could probably sell a half a million records.
We were sitting around in the rented apartment in Los Angeles and talking about ideas for the video, and there was this one film that Kurt was really into where the kids just freak out and take over the school. That was the genesis of it, school and youthful rebellion.
Nirvana hired me because my reel was so bad that it was a very punk and cool thing to do. Let's hire this really crap director to do this video, and we'll get something really kind of not corporate. I saw the band play at the Roxy. We knew we didn't have any money, and the kids were moshing and jumping and doing all this stuff, and I said, that's great, man. We got to get these kids down to the set.
So all these people showed up, and Sam had a bullhorn. By the first chorus, the place was just a riot. The place was going completely, and I remember him screaming into the megaphone, like, stop, cut, stop, cut. And the place was just being torn to shreds, you know? It was hilarious.
It looked like the greatest gig you could ever imagine, you know? High school gone to hell, cheerleaders, dancing around, anarchy, so you get the Black Flag, Minor Threat type of aesthetic in there. It was all there. And there was literally nothing else on television like it.
It changed the entire look of MTV. It made the band successful, and, it helped them sell a lot of records, but it made MTV very successful. It gave them a whole new platform to work from and a whole new set of a whole new generation to like sell to.
I don't think it was cynical, and the media got it all like cynical, grungy, ooh, despair, but it wasn't. It was just a shot of life. And I think that is what everyone responded to.
Some kid heard the song in some mall and started moshing around and fell off the balcony. It was a phenomenon. That energy, something came together. It's really wild, and it affected so many people.
Sometimes you'd show up to a gig and there'd be an extra couple hundred people outside hoping they could get in. And the shows became more and more chaotic.
It's just one of those things that happens maybe once every generation. It's just this rolling, this momentum, word of mouth. You must hear this band Nirvana.
Never mind the fact that they had actually been playing for years. They had made records. In terms of who knew them at one point and how everyone knew them at the next one, it literally was overnight.
Tell that it wasn't like a normal record. Kids weren't reacting to it like a normal record. They were reacting to it like a movement.
In the issue of Billboard that was dated January 12, 1992, Nirvana were number one in the Billboard charts. They had knocked Michael Jackson off the top of the charts. Just unbelievable.
That was a pretty big deal at the time, that some Seattle band that we knew had just displaced Michael Jackson in the number one spot on the album charts. That was inconceivable.
Not only did it reach number one, but it kind of just like, it just broadened out and like completely changed the demographic of what the rock audience was, you know, in the USA, and then it went global, you know. I mean, it was crazy.
We weren't prepared for it, and it's never been a main goal of ours. You know, we really don't care about anything like that. We just want to put out a good record, hopefully. The people who liked our first album would like this one also.
Hello, Space Shower TV. We are Nirvana. I am Kurt.
Hello, Space Shower TV. We are Nirvana, and I am
You
Dave.
Have your hand over it.
Hello, Golden Shower TV. I am Chris, and we are Nirvana.
Well, what do you think about interviews?
What do I think?
Really Did you hear my reaction when he asked me if I wanted to do one?
Yeah.
I said, fuck no. I said, heck no.
We weren't on a mission. We just wanted to make a great record. And so that's where I think it was tough. Because, yeah, sure, you know, Kurt probably wanted to sell 20 million records and be the biggest band in the world. But I'm sure he didn't want all the baggage that came along with it. I'm sure he didn't even realize what baggage came along with that. Nobody did. I didn't.
It seems like everybody changed. I mean, we had to, because change was thrust upon us, and then he bore the brunt of it. He was the creative force behind the band. And, of course, being the guitar player and the singer, the traditional front person role, and it's a tough gig. And, you know, obviously it was hard.
What people expect of you with regards to the largeness of moving masses of people, you know, people follow you unconditionally. And the part at which it was unconditional for Kurt, he couldn't understand.
And I think what he found, which is certainly true, I think, of many successful people, is that he became rich and famous, and all the same things were still there. He was still from a divorced family. He still had difficult relationships with that family, and he still struggled for his place in the world.
Kurt, or Nirvana's greatest legacy, was to bring the underground overground.
It wasn't that only the kids from the wrong side of the tracks got it. Everybody got it.
His message was for a specific group of tormented people that you know, that he knew were out there, that were struggling, and he knew that if he could reach them in a way that there were a lot of them waiting to hear it, you know, and he was right, you know, he knew all along.
You know, you've got to give the music business a kick in the balls now, you know. And that's what it did, you know. And that's why it's a classic album. Eh?
It's a perfect storm. So many things just lined up the right way. And that was Nevermind.
Changed my life, and it changed everyone's life, you know, affiliated with it, all the way down the line. And those don't come by very often. When they do, it's a magic moment.
When I listen to that album, I hear a sense of purity and honesty that I haven't heard in a long time, I guess.
Three people made that record. You know, a drum set and a bass and guitar, and it's undeniably the best thing I ever did in my whole life.